comunismo!
I have family in Cuba, it's my country, I have a lot of people there, they are dying every day, they don't have food, they don't have medicine, they don't have rice, they don't have freedom, and that is the only the people have in their life. If you don't have freedom, you have nothing. They live in a country, it's a dictatorship for 62 years, and that is no any way that people can live like that. They don't have any human rights, and the man is in the power right now, calling himself president, he kills people in the street, even children, he don't care. He has a lot of innocent people in the jail right now, torturing, they don't care. The government don't care about the Cuban people. They just want to make his way, keep the power, keep the money in that poker, and they don't care about the life of Cuban people. So it's time for the communist end, not only in Cuba, in Venezuela, Nicaragua, and we can see a lot of conspiracy with the communists. Maybe even here, because the government is not doing nothing. A lot of high levers, the ONU organization, nobody's doing nothing. Everybody's seeing how they are killing people, innocent, even children, how they are putting people in jail for no reason, and nobody's doing nothing. So that gives the people a lot for thinking.
You have family?
Yes, I have family there. Even if I don't have family, don't care, because my people is Cuban, and I want the freedom and the human rights for them. Cuba deserves to be free. All the countries deserve to be free. That way nobody needs to die, try to get here in this country, because this country, the most powerful is the freedom the people have. And for that reason, because the people is coming here, and die is the way to get here. So let's help that country be free too. For they don't need to die. The people show, don't care if they die. It's better die riot than die in that jail. Because when you live in Cuba, you live in a giant jail. The government say who can get in and who can get out. The government say what you can eat and what you think they eat. Okay? Even if you work, you don't have the money enough for buying the stuff you need for me.
Mi nombre es Vidaly Santi Esteban Hernández y digo mi nombre completo porque ya no tengo miedo, no me interesa volver a Cuba. Estuve en Cuba hace menos de 15 días y puedo ser testigo. Soy testigo de que en Cuba en estos momentos no hay medicina, no hay comida literalmente en ninguna parte. Y los pocos productos que se encuentran en estos momentos en las tiendas de justicia en Cuba son productos que tenemos aquí en las tiendas de Estados Unidos, lo cual es una vergüenza. No todo el mundo tiene acceso a este tipo de tiendas. De hecho, mi papá no podía ir a esa tienda hasta que yo llegué y le pude ayudar con una tarjeta y él pudo comprar. Es bien ofensivo para todos los cubanos lo que está pasando en este momento en Cuba. Y estamos aquí sobre todo para que ellos sepan que estamos con ellos, aunque sea en la mente.
¿Qué es lo que quieren lograr?
Democracia en Cuba es lo que más necesitamos en estos momentos para ese país. Democracia, que todos los humanos que se encuentran en estos momentos sufriendo lo que están sufriendo en Cuba tengan el derecho de poder hablar sin ser censurados, sin ser castigados, sin ser acosados y maltratados tanto fuera de su casa
qué va a pasar mañana.
So after 2 months after July 11th, we are we've gathered in the internet and many forums to with the Cuban people to find a day where the whole Cuban community, every Cuban, can protest and finally put the international community aware of the dictatorship, what they do to its people, and the Cuban people are supposed to come out November 15th and in massive protests throughout the country. And we want to support that. We want to put every camera, every eye, every headline on them, because they're the main characters in this story. They're the ones that are suffering the oppression. They're the ones that have more than 500 people in prison for just protesting, just for peacefully assembling. And the least thing we can do is support them and make sure that they get the visibility they deserve for putting their lives in the line for us, for every Cuban.
And may I ask, were you born here or
I was Cuba? Born in Cuba. I was born in Cuba. I came at the age of 10. And America's my home, and I owe everything to America, but my homeland is over there. And there's a lot of people like me, I'm visually impaired myself, who are suffering. People with disabilities over there have no rights, no way to advocate for themselves. Any person really doesn't have the opportunity to stand up and defend their rights. There's no civil rights as we know them here in the U.S. or throughout the world. The human rights, most of them are violated every day in the island of Cuba, and people don't know about it. And that's why we're making our voices heard, and that's why we're supporting them with every inch of energy we have.
And how do you think the Cuban government will respond tomorrow?
We think that we're already seeing signs. All the activists who signed the letters to try to do a peaceful protest, they did a exercise where they tried to ask for permission to protest and assemble, and all it was denied. And everybody who signed that letter inside Cuba, every activist, right now is either in prison. In the last 3 days, they threw them in jail, the ones that were still out, and the other ones have police escorts outside their house of more than 3 or 4 cops. And the leaders of this movement, of the 15N or 15N, they all have what we call actos de repudio, which is they get people who still support the dictatorship to go to those people's homes and repudiate them by throwing them slogans, throwing them eggs to their houses, and making sure they don't come out. And if they come out, they're going to face just mobs of paid people that will, torture them or beat them up or whatever to make sure they don't go out on the streets and peaceably ask for, freedoms.
And what do you think led to the July 11 protests? Why didn't they happen sooner?
Because of many factors. 2 years of isolation, 2 years of Cubans outside feeding through internet, a lot of information. In Cuba, there's heavy indoctrination. The Cuban government owns all means of communications. and that changed with the internet. So that's one factor. The second factor was the COVID. The Cubans have always said that one of their pillars is their medicine, their healthcare sector, and it completely failed during COVID. Their vaccine didn't really work. There's still a lot of cases of COVID. People were dying because they didn't have oxygen. There was not enough doctors. And none of that really got told to the international community, but that was what's happening. And the third factor was hunger. A lot of people really couldn't find food, but they know that because of the information they received by the more than 3 million Cubans outside of Cuba, who are the ones that sustain the dictatorship with our remittance and with the money to support our families, they know the true story. And they said they were fed up. They realized the fakeness and the indoctrination they've been fed, and it was time for them to. It was a spontaneous moment where they saw an opportunity to finally try to overthrow that regime. And I think they saw that opportunity. There's never, and I think once they felt breathe that opportunity of protest, now it's going to be continuing on until they get rid of the regime.
And do you still have family members in Cuba?
Yes, sir. Yeah, I have a close family. I have half brother and half sister. I have grandparents. I have my uncles, my aunts, and in Cuba, family is a big thing. We all typically live on the same household. Most of my immediate family, except my mom and my dad, are over there. So yeah, I have plenty of family over there. And we understand that it's a critical moment. It's a moment where every Cuban needs to step up and finally say no to communism, say no to oppression, and fight for human rights.
And how is your family doing over there now?
They're getting by. Obviously, before the 2 years pandemic and all that kind of stuff, they had a lot of support from us. So they have ways of surviving and getting by. But each time the situation gets worse. Inflation in Cuba is through the roof. People really can't afford most daily supplies, whether it's soap, things, basic necessities, for a long time. But now it's even worse. Now people are having to really be creative in the ways they trade in the black market for food, in the way they trade for medicine. There's no medicine in the pharmacies in Cuba. And if it wasn't because of the exiles, all the Cubans outside the island, the Cuban people would literally be North Korea levels, or they would definitely be suffering because there's no medicine supplies, there's very low food supplies. So they're getting by, but Cuba has gotten used to living with very low resources. And now they're learning that there's a different way to fight for those resources besides just dealing with what's there. Besides settling for what's given to them, they're finding out that they can really change their future, especially people my age, 35 and younger. They're finally, they don't believe any of the government propaganda. They realize that the future of Cuba is in our hands and we can change history.
And have you been back to Cuba since leaving?
Many times. Until 2018, I probably went, I came in 2001, I probably went about 15 times to Cuba. My times when I was in middle school, high school, and college. Went many times. That's why I haven't really left Cuba, because I have many friends and family there, and I've gone so many times. Obviously now I probably, I don't know. I don't know if I will be allowed back in the country. They tend to restrict people who go even in outside of Cuba, protest the government and go out on media, on social media, and post the reality. They tend to sanction us and not allow us back in the country. That may happen, but it doesn't matter. It's a price that we all need to pay, because it's a time to do something about it and start whining about everything that's happened to us. It's time to really change our reality. And if that means not being able to go to my own country, not being able to be accepted in Cuba, then that's a pay we'll play. I'll pay when there's people sacrificing literally their life inside the island. It's nothing to not be allowed back in. It's nothing.
Do you know, do you have an idea of what you think the U.S. government should do, if anything?
Yeah, I think the U.S. government, first of all, there was appropriations passed to provide an internet solution for Cuba. There's internet blockades right now in Cuba where people, the internet has been slowed down today. And tomorrow, which is the day of protest in Cuba, we know that they're going to cut out all types of internet. So we need the internet, especially since it already has been passed. We need those solutions to be tried. We need at least the effort from the U.S. government to, they said they were going to help us with that so we can promote democracy and promote freedom, and we need that help. And then the next thing is solidarity. You know, there was another bill called Patria y Vida that was passed in Congress and still have 40 votes against. And all it said was just pretty much to stand with the people of Cuba. We need complete solidarity with people who are wanting some of the same rights and freedoms we have here. So we just want solidarity and obviously the internet. And yes, to as leaders that we are and as the most powerful nation on earth, lead the world to isolate Cuba and to make that government leave power and let Cubans decide for themselves and have democracy.
And was it difficult for your family to leave Cuba?
Extremely difficult. Again, we because of family life, you do everything within the family. At the same time, they didn't see any future for me as a disability. I was never enrolled in school. Because they did not accept me in public schools. They want me to go to a special needs school, and my parents did not accept that at the time. So really for my parents, yeah, it was a difficult decision, but they had to find a way out for me to have a future. And they knew that there was no future for me inside Cuba at the time. There was also, my parents knew that with that government, they also themselves wouldn't have many opportunities to give me a better life. And it was a family decision to do anything they could to get me out. So the least I can do also is to support their sacrifice to let me have the opportunity to live in freedoms and the opportunities I've had here in the States.
And one last question. Besides helping to increase internet access in Cuba, do you think the U.S. should either increase sanctions or look for a military solution?
I think the U.S. should, like I said at the beginning of the interview, I think part of the problem is also us Cubans, because of the need we have to help our people in Cuba. We send a lot of money. On Monday, when the protest starts, there's 17 flights from Miami going into Cuba. Each flight is average, an estimate of a study by a university that I don't have the name of right now, about $200,000 per flight. And unfortunately, not just that, when people go, we're not conscious enough to know that when we're renting a car to go see our family members, or when we're renting a hotel to take our family members somewhere, we're enabling the dictatorship. We're giving oxygen, which is the finances of the oppressors. And we need to change that. And we hope that the Cuban government helps us to sanction ourselves, the Cubans, to not be able to do that, and to not be able to keep giving the Cuban government more money. I understand that we have humanitarian efforts that we can do to keep helping the people, that can go straight to the people with international overseers, or with U.S. Entities that can go maybe and provide the help themselves, people to people. But we need to stop the money into the dictatorship's hands. So yes, we believe that more sanctions, especially if they can help us really codify the embargo to everyone, including Cuban-Americans, then I think we will have a much better effort in getting the dictatorship out of there. Because if they don't have money, they can't function, and that'll be decapitating to their economy.
I don't have any other questions. Is there anything else you would like to add?
Padre Vida, please share any news you see about Cuba. Please visualize it. What we hope is that Americans really have the solidarity of the Cuban people by sharing our story, by telling our story, and by joining us in this struggle. Because at the end, if we're able to liberate Cuba, we truly believe we will also liberate most of Latin America, especially starting with Venezuela and Nicaragua.
Why did you decide to come out today?
My heart called out. I came here when I was 6 years old because my father had to flee from the communist government. And I've grown up here, but half of my family's there. I miss my grandparents' funeral. I mean, we were separated. I don't know if you can hear me.
I can hear you.
Separated, a lot of suffering. And although I grew up here, and I was blessed to be here and have all the wonderful things of this country, I feel for my family. I have 20 family members in Cuba that depend on my money, and they're suffering. They can't even speak out. They can't even walk out of their doors today.
And have you been back to Cuba since?
I've been back twice to visit grandparents and aunts and uncles. And
what was that experience like?
It was horrifying. You know, I knew that it was going to be bad, that it was poor, but it was worse than I expected. You know, sewage running down Havana. You know, the biggest city, the most touristy, popular city, in shambles, broken down. My family, we lost power for 3 nights, 3 days, no water, no electricity, and that's every day for them.
What do you think is going to happen in Cuba tomorrow?
I'm afraid they're going to shut it down, because they're already shutting it down. They're already going to all the leaders, all the newspaper folks that write in the news. They're already standing guard by their door. They have people that are in the military dressed in civilian clothing, parked in front of their cars, and not letting them come out. And I believe they're going to be arrested. I believe they're going to be arrested if they try to come out. So I'm very saddened about that. We're all praying for a miracle. I mean, I know right now there's global prayer going on at 4 o'clock. Worldwide, there's a Zoom prayer for the Cuban people that are trying to just speak out. So we can only hope for that. But this president dictator believes that he's under threat. And he's even blaming the U.S. for them wanting to walk out and speak out just for freedom and for free elections. They want what everybody else has now, you know. So we don't know. We don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, but they're trying to shut it down tonight. All the leaders that they know of, they have parked cars in front of their houses waiting to arrest them.
And what do you think the U.S. government should do, if anything?
That's a tough question. I do believe in sanctions. This whole opening up of tourism is just going to strengthen the government's pocket. It affects very little. When President Obama opened it up, it affected very little the actual Cuban person, their income, because the government owns everything and they control everything. They control all that money. There's no free market for the Cuban people. And so I don't think it helps to open it up and just feed that government. That's an authoritarian, it's a dictatorship, and they're in your home, they tell you what to do, they tell you how to live, there's no personal freedoms, no human rights.
And what's the biggest message that you would like, you know, for people who don't really follow Cuba much and don't know what's going on there, what would you say is the biggest message that you would like people to hear?
They need to speak maybe to their representatives and let them know that maybe when it comes to voting, that we do need their support, we do need the U.S. support to tighten sanctions, to put pressure, you know, economical and political pressure. The U.S. does feed Cuba. People think that the U.S. isn't doing anything for Cuba and that they claim that they're being hurt by the, quote, embargo. But the U.S. sends medicine and food every day to Cuba. You don't hear that in the news. So I think just being aware of, you know, how to put pressure on that regime to open up free elections. And it's got to be an economical pressure. It's got to be some kind of change. I don't know what it's going to take, but I'm not sure what this presidency is going to do. I wish they would do something to help the Cuban people, not the government.
No tengo ninguna otra pregunta en inglés, pero hay algo en español que quisiera decir.
Español. Si los cubanos en Cuba no me oyen mi palabra, estamos con ustedes, estamos rezando con ustedes, estamos fuerte aquí al lado de ustedes, que sigan en las calles, que hablen, que se representen y que Dios los va a ayudar. Estamos aquí con ustedes, nosotros aquí en los Estados Unidos, el mundo entero, que sigan, Cuba libre, que sigan, los amamos.
Gracias. Muy amable. ¡Sí! ¡Libre!